Hey everyone, Robin here from postprofessionals.de, back from a somewhat longer break just because there's been so much other stuff to do. But I'm hoping and I actually plan to do a lot more English tutorials as opposed to German ones, as I have been up until now, all surrounding Final Cut Pro 10 and motion in the near future. If that's something that you'd like to see, then maybe show me with the old thumbs up or even a sub and click on the little bell to be notified once it actually happens. But enough of that. There's been yet another free update for Final Cut Pro 10, motion and compressor, the 27th actually for Final Cut Pro since its inception. And with this video, I just want to give you a quick overview of what's new so that maybe you don't have to look quite as hard or even maybe even see something that you hadn't caught yourself. Basically, all the, in my opinion, biggest, most relevant additions and or improvements. So let's take a look. So after installing the update and starting Final Cut Pro for the first time, you get the usual what's new splash screen with a list of the top four new features according to Apple. Starting with the all-new workflow extensions, this being a new API, as they're called, for third-party developers that finally allows them to directly integrate functionality into the Final Cut Pro interface. I'll actually be doing an extra video to show this off using the brand new Frame.io workflow extension that was just announced, which will make your working with their already brilliant site even easier and more productive. Here, just a quick preview. But I also know that users of certain media asset management applications can look forward to some very interesting updates in the near future as well. And from past experience, I think we can expect to see various other very nice third-party improvements for Final Cut Pro that take advantage of this new API. So let's wait and see what they come up with. Either way, it's definitely a huge improvement. The other three in this list, namely batch sharing, in other words batch export, the new video noise reduction filter, as well as the two new timecode windows, are features we of course want to look at now, next to a few bigger and smaller features and improvements that aren't listed here. So I'll just click continue and we can take a look at the new batch sharing. The feature that I personally have been begging for a long time, as I know a lot of other people have too. Why, I think, is easily demonstrated by this library in particular that has my rather comprehensive German language Final Cut Pro 10 training in it. Here you see that this library consists of a whopping 130 chapters, or rather projects. And I think you can probably roughly imagine what this meant up until now when it came time to export these for upload. Best case scenario, I literally had to hit Command E 130 times and then return just as often to get everything exported. Just keeping track of what I had actually already exported and what I hadn't was in itself a tedious task. Well, fortunately, that's now history. Now, if I want to just export, say, the first 8 chapters, or rather share them, as Final Cut calls it, I can select all of them and then simply right-click any one of them and choose Share 8 Project and then the desired destination. Or select the same command via the File menu, or even send 8 of them to Compressor all at the same time. Or do the same through the Share menu at the top right. Whichever share option I choose, I get the usual export window. But now I see all of the selected projects listed on the left side, with the usual description, creator, and tags field on the right. Whereby, obviously, if I were to enter anything into the description field where it currently says multiple values, then the entry would, of course, be applied to every project being exported, assuming that's even practical. Leaving this untouched will, of course, export each project with the description that I entered in the project's information inspector. The dimension and frame rate information is shown since it's the same for all projects in this case, just no time indicator since each project has a different length. On the right, I do see that I will be creating 8 files and, what I think is a really nice touch, a total size of all projects. In other words, what Final Cut Pro estimates the joint size of all the clips will be. But if I want to know the estimated size for individual projects, or rather clips, I just have to mouse over the value field and I get a pop-up with the size of each project, or rather clip, listed individually. Nice. And as usual, the chosen destination is listed at the bottom left. After clicking Next and selecting where I want to save them, we can see in the background tasks window how in fact all of the projects are being rendered one after another. Next up, the all-new noise reduction filter. To demonstrate this, I've loaded up a classic example of noisy footage, namely a video from a cell phone that was recorded during a concert in a low-light situation. Anyone who already has a third-party noise reduction filter will know how many of them can be pretty complicated to set up. But even worse than that, most of them will be painfully slow to render. I, for one, don't know of many noise reduction filters that in fact don't need up to seconds worth to render just one frame after being applied. Something that obviously not only slows down your workflow considerably, but also makes for exponentially longer render times upon export. Well, Apple would appear to have alleviated both these issues associated with noise reduction while still delivering impressive results. I'll just apply it to my clip here so we can take a look at it. And seeing that it is a filter, or rather effect, it can of course be found in my effects browser. After dragging it from here, from under the basics category onto my clip, we can look in the inspector under effects to take a look at the available parameters. And I think it's pretty apparent at first sight setting this up couldn't be any easier. And as we'll also see in the moment, the speed at which it's rendered is also pretty amazing. How the quality of the results compare pixel for pixel to other commercial noise reduction filters, for example, I can't actually say beyond just a few unscientific comparisons to, which we'll get to in a second. But if there's a specific noise reduction filter you'd like to see this compared to, let me know in the comments and I'll see what I can do. So as we can see in the inspector, we have a whopping two parameters for setting up our noise reduction. First, a pop-up menu for the amount of noise reduction, ranging from low to maximum, followed by a pop-up menu for setting the level of sharpening, ranging from none to maximum. By default, these are set to medium and low, which from my initial experience is actually great for most material. Obviously, any given clip may need more or less of one or the other. So if I move further down the clip to an area where we see this blue sky with some balloons, where I'd say the amount of noise is most easily visible, and I just switch the noise reduction on and off with its check mark, I think the improvement is pretty obvious. But what's even more impressive is the speed at which it's rendered. Because no matter whether I change the amount of noise reduction via the pop-up menu, or just move to another part of the clip, all I ever see is a very short processing noise reduction message at the bottom of the viewer, barely long enough to even read it, and already the noise reduction has been applied. If parked on one frame, I could even try out all the different levels of reduction, and it's only ever rendered once. Meaning if I return to a previous setting, it's shown to me in real time without even seeing the brief message in the viewer. So basically, I can check out any and all levels of noise reduction within seconds without wasting minutes of my life just to get the best possible results. Of course, generally using the higher settings will progressively soften the image altogether, in turn requiring higher sharpness levels. Whereby overdoing either, or even both, will obviously increasingly result in an unnatural looking image. So again, being able to experiment with any given combination practically in real time is an amazing time saver. Especially when you'll want to experiment with different settings at different positions in the clip to find the best average overall settings. But as if that weren't amazing enough, the real kicker is that if the clip has not yet been rendered with the noise reduction applied, then the filter actually deactivates itself when the clip is played. That way, you always have the best possible performance upon playback without having to render the clip in advance. Something that was generally unthinkable when applying noise reduction in the past, next to simply leaving the noise reduction deactivated until the very end. In fact, my workflow of choice up until now. For my aforementioned unscientific comparison, I've simply duplicated the clip on top of itself and applied the noise reduction from Final Cut Pro to one of them, and Neat Video's noise reduction filter version 4.8 to the other, and cropped the top one down the middle. This way we see half of each clip on either side. Whereby I should probably mention I only used the more or less automatic settings from the Neat filter and didn't fiddle with it for ages. From experience, something I will normally actually have to do with Neat, and is one of those little rabbit holes that one can easily fall into. But even then, applying it requires much more time and clicking before getting back to my project. Of course, all of that aside from the fact that I also have to jump out of Final Cut Pro into an extra window to apply it out of context and have to do the same should any adjustments be necessary. So just in terms of workflow, Final Cut's own noise reduction is a huge boon to the whole process. The Final Cut noise reduction is set to high for the amount and low for the sharpness. Now if I activate the crop and adjust it left and right to show more or less of each image, assuming that any of this actually survives YouTube's compression algorithm enough for you to even be able to tell, then you'll see that the differences are nearly indistinguishable. In this particular case at least, I would maybe even go so far and say that Final Cut's noise reduction is a little bit better overall. For me personally, the result is more than acceptable, and certainly worth saving the extra money for a third-party filter in this case. In the case of Neat, that works out to a $75 to $250 saving, depending on your host app. What the difference in performance is also easily shown by simply hitting the spacebar and playing it back. As we can see, as opposed to the Final Cut noise reduction applied to the clip itself, playback is now considerably more choppy. Basically, if you ask me, unusable if not rendered, and the performance one would actually expect with any other noise reduction filter applied to your footage. But again, just a quick unscientific test, so give it a shot with your own footage and let me know what you think in the comments below. Maybe you have Neat or any other third-party filter and can compare it. And if you do, let us know what your impressions and results are in the comments as well. Next, we want to look at the not one, but two new timecode windows. This being yet another feature that I know a lot of people have been begging for a while, including myself. While there have been third-party solutions that are even free, aside from some of them being literal hacks, which is never really a great idea, others didn't have an option for displaying source timecode. Both of these new windows can be found, surprise, surprise, in the window menu. Selecting the project timecode opens the timecode floating window, which has the name of the currently active project at the top, as well as, of course, displaying the timecode of the current position of the playhead or skimmer of said project, depending on which is currently active. The timecode for clips in the event are still only displayed under the viewer. You can, of course, scale the window up and down to your liking, and it also has a pop-up menu at the top right with which you can select three different levels of transparency for the window. So this window by itself should actually excite and please a lot of people. But where it gets really interesting is with the second timecode window for source timecode, which we can find in the Windows menu as well below the project timecode. Choosing this opens yet another floating window. This one already has much more information by default. As the name says, it shows me the timecode not of the project, but rather both the name as well as the timecode of the clip or clips that my playhead or skimmer are currently positioned over. I can, of course, resize this window as well, but unlike the project timecode window, I can change the vertical and horizontal size independently. But aside from just simply displaying name and source timecode, the color of the individual clips also tells me which role the clip has been assigned. So blue for video dialogue, green for music, and so on. But it goes even further than that. Selecting a clip in the timeline, for example, also selects its name and timecode in the window with the same yellow outline. And while we were given the ability to copy the current project timecode in the edit menu a few versions back, you can now even right-click any clip in the source timecode window and are given the option to either copy the current timecode of that clip or even copy the current timecode and name, by the way, of every clip listed in the window all at the same time. So if I do that and switch over to any random app that allows text entry, say for example the Notes app, and hit Command V, all of the aforementioned information is pasted into the document. That's pretty cool if you ask me. And I think a lot of users as well as developers are going to be excited and thankful for it. And if having two of these windows open at the same time takes up too much screen real estate for you, then you can simply close the project timecode window. And if we click on the pop-up menu at the top right of the source timecode window, we see here, next to the same transparency settings as in the project timecode window, two additional display options at the top. The first one being project timecode. Selecting this adds the same project timecode information at the top of the list. So with that, I can save myself having to have two windows open at once. but I can just as well turn other information on or off too. So, for example, if the color of the clip's roll is not enough for me to correctly identify it, I can also add its name. Selecting it adds its roll name to the clip information in between its name and timecode. So a really nice implementation of the whole concept, if you ask me. So what do you think? Let me know down in the comments. Next on our list of new features, yet another great improvement that I know a lot of people, including myself, have been waiting and hoping for a long time. A great new feature concerning color correction, which was just barely available through some third-party plugins in one form or another, but still not the same way or quite as powerful as this. And having something built in is obviously always preferred anyway. That thing being the new Comparison Viewer, which can be found in the Window menu in the Show in Workspace submenu. Selecting this or simply hitting its shortcut, Control-Command-6, opens the Comparison Viewer to the left of the Standard Viewer window. In this case, the first thing I see is a very similar image displayed as the one I see on the right. But if I skim over my clip or timeline, we see that only the image on the right changes, but the one on the left stays static. That's because if we look at the bottom of the Comparison Viewer window, we can see by its blue highlight that Next Edit is selected. In other words, we're seeing the first frame of the next clip in my timeline relative to my playhead. So if I skim over the second clip, the Comparison Viewer goes black, since now that is what is next in the timeline. Nothing. But if I park my playhead over the second clip, I can, of course, simply switch to Previous Edit, after which the first frame of the previous clip is displayed. We can also see that two clips are not color corrected the same and look noticeably different. That's because I've only corrected the second, but not the first clip. But on top of it all, the overall lighting changed in between the two takes as well. In other words, if that were not the case, then I could of course simply copy the second clip with Command-C, select the first clip and hit Command-Shift-V to use the Paste Attributes command to paste the same three color correction filters that I applied to the second clip to the first clip as well, and everything would look fine. But after doing that, thanks to the new Comparison Viewer, I can see that there is still an obvious discrepancy between the two. So until now, I had to constantly move my playhead or skimmer between the two clips to get a fair comparison to match them up as best possible. Obviously, a rather tedious and not very user-friendly experience. But that is, of course, now history. I can just stop at any point in my clip, go into the color inspector, and adjust my exposure and saturation as needed to match both shots perfectly. Opening the scopes window, which no color correction should be without, with Command-7, it opens to the left of my viewer. But if I activate the Comparison Viewer window by clicking on it and hit Command-7 again, a second scopes window opens to the left of it, which can be individually customized and is of course great for making sure that I get both images graded as close to each other as the footage allows. This in itself is of course great, but what do I do if the two shots I want to compare are not consecutive in the timeline? When, for example, as in this case, there's a cutaway to an entirely different shot in between the two. Or maybe even the first frame of the previous or next edit isn't the one I need or want for comparison. Or the clip I want for comparison isn't even in this project, but rather in a different one within my library. Well, for all of the above, we have a second tab at the top of the Comparison Viewer window called Saved. If we switch over to it, we see nothing. Of course, because, as the name says, it displays saved images, and I haven't in fact saved anything yet. But I can of course do that very easily by simply positioning my playhead over the frame that I want in my timeline, and then clicking the Save Frame button at the bottom right of the viewer. With that, the Comparison Viewer, or rather in this case, we'll call it a frame store, is populated with the image from my timeline, and I can now return to my third clip and adjust my color correction accordingly. I'm able to store up to 30 images per a library, and these are in fact stored within the library until I delete them. To see how many and which frames I've stored so far, I just need to open the Frame Browser window by clicking the button at the bottom left of the Comparison Viewer. Here I'm shown all of the images that I've saved from any and all projects within this library, meaning that any and all frames that I have saved in any given project within the same library, so even from a different event, will appear here, and I can use them as a comparison in any project at any time. Maybe as a little extra pro tip, There's also a new entry in the command editor for saving a frame, but it doesn't actually have a shortcut assigned to it by default. So if this is something I see myself needing a lot, I can simply open the command editor with Option Command K, search for Save Frame, and simply drag this command to whatever shortcut I would like to use. For example, F8. Then save the new command set, and from now on, if I go back to my concert video, for example, and skim across it, wherever and whenever I press F8, that frame is automatically saved to my frame browser. And since, as I said, these are accessible within any and every project within the same library, I can return to my interview project and select any of the frames that I stored from the concert video to use as a comparison in the comparison viewer. If I want to delete any of the saved frames, I simply select them in the frame browser and hit delete. But assuming I've hit my 30 image limit, starting with the 31st image, they would automatically be deleted starting with the oldest first. As an additional little tip, if you look inside the library itself, you can now find a new folder called underscore snapshots at the top level. Here, you'll actually find any and all snapshots that you've saved in full quality and resolution as a TIFF, even if they all have very cryptic names. In other words, if I were to pass this library over to somebody else or even just open it on another machine, I'd still have access to any and all snapshots made by myself or even someone else. Very nice. Next up, just a little improvement for those of you for whom 360-degree VR video is of any interest. Here, Apple has added an additional mapping option for VR material that you might be using in a regular HD project, namely the popular Tiny Planet effect. So now if I'm using a 360-degree VR clip in a non-VR project, as in this case, I can go into the Clips Inspector, and under the Orientation section and Mapping, I now have an option to set it from Normal to Tiny Planet. Again, something that until now was only possible with additional commercial plugins. Now with the mapping set to Tiny Planet, I can create those ever-popular spherical looks. And using my roll and tilt parameters, I can wrap my Tiny Planet effect into an infinite cylinder. Adjusting the pan parameters moves my subject horizontally within the Tiny Planet, and I can animate the field of view to transition from a close-up to a satellite view as if I were flying high above my footage. And this, of course, goes for 360-degree titles and generators, where I can also create a powerful warped look by applying the Tiny Planet mapping option to them. Of course, animatable as well. And yet another couple of features that I know I would have liked right from the beginning as far as captions are concerned, but better late than never, is the ability to import, edit, and create captions in the SRT format. So even though there were easy ways of creating SRT files from ITT or CA6OA captions, it still was an additional, seemingly rather superfluous step one had to take. And with it, we of course get that little bit more compatible with sites such as YouTube and Facebook. But aside from that, you now also have the option to create open captions from 608 captions. Meaning if you've created closed captions in the 608 format, you can use these to automatically create burnt-in titles for your clip. Again, something that, until now, was only possible by jumping through various hoops and using third-party applications. But let's start at the top. I have a project here that already has German subtitles in the ITT format. I can now use these to either convert them into SRT formatted captions or use them to create SRT formatted captions in addition to the existing ones. To do that, I simply need to first create a new subtitle role. I can simply right-click one of the subtitles in my timeline and go to Assign Caption Roles, where I can already see that I only have ITT captions as an option. And here, just select Edit Roles, or if I don't have any captions at all yet, I can go into the Modify menu and select it here. Either way, the window for editing the library's roles opens. Here I just need to click the little plus button at the top right, labeled Caption Role, where I'm presented with the now three caption options that I can create. ITT and 608 at the top, now with the addition of SRT as my third. So selecting SRT adds a new SRT role with English as the default language. And as usual, I can, if I want to, use the small minus button in front of either to delete them. But since my subtitles are in German, I of course went to change them over, which I can do by clicking on the language button on the roles bar. And from the seemingly endless list of language options, I'll go to German and then Germany and select it. And since we'll need them in a minute, and I'm here anyway, I'll just create a 608 role as well and do the same. Now all I have to do is click Apply. Back in my timeline, if I didn't already have any captions, I could just hit Option C to create a new one. And in the pop-up at the top of the window that appears, I now see all three formats as an option. I'll just delete it again since I don't want any new captions, but would actually like to convert my existing captions so that I don't have to retype them all over again. Having selected one, all I have to do is hit Command A to select them all, right-click any one of them, and simply select Assign Caption Roles, and then whichever format I prefer. And since not every caption format supports the same text formatting and other things, something one should, of course, keep in mind when converting, I'm given a warning that the conversion could result in loss of text or formatting. I'll simply confirm by clicking Continue, and with that, I would now have the option to save my captions in the SRT format upon export. Alternatively, if I want to keep my ITT captions as well, I could also right-click and duplicate them into any random language first, and then simply assign the duplicates whichever other caption role, and with that, caption format that I like. Now if I export my clip and look under the Roles tab, I can choose to output one or all caption files in their respective format as a sidecar file. These I can then simply upload alongside the clip itself to YouTube, Vimeo, Facebook, or whatever hosts I'm using that accepts either format. But there's actually one more thing that has been added that isn't quite as obvious. There's a new, rather inconspicuous button to the right of my video track labeled Captions. Clicking this actually gives me yet another window with two additional options. The first option giving me the possibility to embed my CEA 608 captions directly into the movie file, assuming I even have any. Meaning I don't necessarily have to create a sidecar file for my 608 captions, but rather they can be extracted from within the clip itself. The second option probably being the one most people, again like myself, would have liked to have from the get-go. This option allows me to define which of the existing captions I can have used as open caption titles, meaning burnt-in subtitles that can't be deactivated. I'll just choose to embed my 608 titles, and then select my SRT captions to be burnt in, and export my clip so we can take a look at what that even means in practice. After exporting and opening the clip in the QuickTime player, you can see I now have an additional button in the navigation bar with the same icon we saw in Final Cut. Clicking this, of course, allows me to activate the now embedded captions. Scrolling through the clip, I can see that I also have the burnt-in titles, which clearly makes the embedded captions pretty pointless. But then, there's even one more thing. If I re-import that same clip into Final Cut Pro, it gets a unique icon in the event with the little speech bubble on it, signaling me that it has embedded captions. But if that weren't enough, if I edit the clip back into my project, I can even right-click it and I'm given the option to extract the captions at the bottom. Selecting this automatically generates caption files in my timeline, frame accurately, just as I set them up in the original clip. So that's pretty cool. By the way, should you choose to export a project using Final Cut Pro's YouTube API, for example, you'll even see the two options for including captions and burning in captions here at the bottom of the settings window as well. In which case, you obviously can skip having to upload a sidecar file in addition to the actual clip. So, again, a very cool improvement for anyone working with subtitles of any kind. To finish up this section on Final Cut Pro, just a few smaller improvements and changes that I find worth pointing out. First off, something that maybe most of you have never even noticed, but those who have will really appreciate this. Namely, the fact that if you've ever tried to select a secondary storyline by dragging a marquee around it, then you are only ever able to select the individual clips, but not the storyline itself as a whole. something that could make moving a storyline along with other selected clips a surprisingly tedious task. Well, that too has changed. Now, if you drag your marquee from the side of the storyline, you still only select the individual clips. But if you drag your marquee from the top of the secondary storyline, then it's selected in its entirety. Yay! There's also something new in the area of filters. There's a new comic looks category that contains 6 comic style filters, whereby they're really all the same filter, just with different presets to start from. And while at first I thought these are probably just some goofy new stylized look that I'll probably never need, after playing around with them a bit, I actually realized that you can create some very interesting looks using them. So I can really recommend just playing around with them for a while and see what you can create. How good or bad an effect looks will obviously depend on the chosen footage. But for one, I found that footage with higher contrast will generally yield the most interesting results. The best part, of course, being that, as usual, it's all in real time. So now you can all go out and make your own aha videos. Now let's take a look at what's changed with Motion and Compressor, which, as usual, is not nearly as much as with Final Cut, but still some interesting new details. Next to Motion, also getting the same comic look filters, as well as the Tiny Planet mapping option for VR material, it's finally gotten the same color correction filters and tools as Final Cut Pro, a very welcome addition. Meaning I can now correct my footage in Motion using the exact same color curves, color wheels, hue and saturation curves, and even custom LUT filters as in Final Cut Pro. Whereby that's not only functionally a superb improvement, but it also opens up some really nice possibilities for third parties or even yourself for creating filters to use in Final Cut Pro. So it should be interesting if and what comes down the pipeline in the near future. Unfortunately though, no scopes, which is a bummer, but there are always future updates to look forward to. Lastly, on the subject of Motion, something I'm sure a lot of foreign language users are going to really appreciate. Namely, in my opinion, long overdue improvements to the core text engine. These improvements now ensure the accurate display of Arabic letters, Indic vowel signs in Devanagari, and Thai diacritics. And in addition to that, it also allows for rendering and animation of emojis, which oddly didn't actually work up until now. Thin glyphs, capital letters in various point sizes, and vertical text are now apparently also joined and tracked correctly. So if any of that was something you've needed in the past, that too is now history. All of which, of course, applies to Final Cut as well. And lastly, Compressor 2 has, of course, gotten a few new additions and improvements. First and foremost, it is now finally 64-bit. I bet you didn't even know it was 32 up until now, huh? Meaning it can now take advantage of all the memory in your Mac to support even higher resolution images and projects. Compressor can now also view, edit, and deliver closed captions in the SRT format as well, and now also uses source media properties to automatically configure MXF and QuickTime settings, if that is something that is in fact relevant to your workflow.
Well, that's it from my end. What did you think? Have a favorite feature, or maybe find something you think I should have mentioned and forgot, or maybe I didn't see it, I don't know. Let me know down in the comments. Join me on Facebook and Twitter and all the rest. Links and infos are in the description. And again, if you liked it, and if it maybe even helped you find something, give me a thumbs up. And if you want to be notified when my video on Frame.io's extension, for example, goes up, then subscribe, hit the little bell, and you'll be notified as soon as I upload anything. But either way, thanks a lot for watching, and maybe see you in the next one.